This project was supported by the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency, through its regional arts funding partnership, Pennsylvania Partners in the Arts, PPA. State government funding for the arts depends upon an annual appropriation by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and support from the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency. PPA is administered in this region by Berks Arts Council. Arts programming on BCTV is also supported by the Wells Fargo Foundation and by Berks Arts Council.
New Arts Alive features a guest artist who will share their work for a better understanding of today's art. Program moderator is James Carroll. During the live presentation, the home viewer has the opportunity to call and speak directly with the artist. New Arts Alive is brought to you by the New Arts Program, a nonprofit arts service organization in cooperation with Berks Community Television. New Arts Alive is supported in part by the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, local government, area businesses, NAP memberships, and individual contributions.
Hi, good afternoon. Welcome to New Arts Alive. I'm your host for tonight. I'm Ron Shira. With me, I have a special guest. I have Craig Czury, who is the Poet Laureate of Berks County. And we'll talk about how one becomes a Poet Laureate in a minute or two here. But I did want to discuss some of the stuff here about him, because he's got quite a significant bio here. So, by the way, hi.
Ron, thank you so much. And I'm always happy to be on this station and be on the show. And Berks County, salute.
Salutes. But for this, which I've taken off of, what is it, Diagen Plus website here, it says that Craig Czury grew up in the coal regions of northeastern Pennsylvania, spent 15 years hitchhiking across North America, working in carnivals, warehouses, canneries, construction crews, restaurant kitchens, organizing community poetry readings. He's the author of 20 collections of poetry. Several have been translated into Spanish, Italian, Lithuanian, Russian, and Albanian. He's the editor of two anthologies, Fine Line That Screams, from his northeastern Pennsylvania prison poetry project, Un Segunda en el Tiempo, which is One Second at a Time, Poets of the Reading Hispanic Community. He works as a poet in schools, homeless shelters, prisons, mental hospitals, and community centers throughout the entire world. He has been named the Laureate of...
go for it, Ryan.
Yeah, Dite y Amit. I'm not quite sure how
now you... That translates to Days of Naim... Naimet. Naim is the national poet of Albania, and in Macedonia, among the Albanians, they have an international poetry festival that I was honored with that from.
That's
a big deal.
That is a big deal. That's wonderful. Well, you've been awarded quite a lot of national and international fellowships as well to continue your collaborative poem fusion performances, poetry mural projects. You're a blues harp and a bocce player. You have an MFA from Wilkes University, and you lecture at Albright College. You live in Reading. And wow, pleasure to have you here.
21 years next week.
In Reading.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
And very fruitful existence here. I have worked in all capacities as a poet, throughout mm-hmm. the city, throughout the county, throughout the underbelly. Berks County has been a magnificent place to be a poet.
Well, I think you have the full breadth and width of life here, just as much as you would have in any major city, where everybody seems to think that the cities carry all of the culture. Not necessarily so. I mean, we have an entire country that's west of New York, so I like to think that there's a lot to learn. So how does one become Poet Laureate?
Well, the laureateship of Berks County has been in existence for, oh geez, I don't know how many years, because I'm the fourth. Mm-hmm. So they give it to, they offer this distinction. I don't even know who thought something like this was important. Somebody at the community college at RAC. And so they award it first to Harry Humes, great poet, another coal region emigre. And Harry held it for years because I think the people who established it forgot about it. Mm-hmm. So Harry was the poet laureate for years. This other guy gets it, you know. And then Heather Thomas gets it, and a lot of years pass, a lot of years. So when they give it to me, they just say, Craig, 2 years. We'll give you 2 years.
2 years.
So the laureateship is up for grabs again now. Applications are available through the Berks Bards Poetry Group and RAC. If you want to go through online, you can look up Berks County Poet Laureate Applications. And the deadline for that is in May. And the selection happens during the summer, and the big ceremony is during October.
Which I missed because I had the opening of my artwork.
That's right, that's right. I remember, and I looked in the audience, and I didn't see you there.
Yeah. Night was ruined after that.
Well, somebody tipped me off that you were at your own opening, so it's better than your own funeral.
Yeah, that's right. Well, I hope I attend my funeral.
I hope you don't. Come on.
Not recently.
Come on. Just you know, have it and don't show up.
Just don't show up. I don't want to show up at my funeral. I'm not there. Don't look for me. I won't be there. So all of this, so you do quite a bit of traveling, too.
Yes, yes. I've been really grateful because growing up in the coal region, Wilkes-Barre area, English was not my first language. My father was first generation Hungarian, and my grandmother lived in our house, and she spoke Hungarian, and we all grew up trying to figure out what was being talked about. And in our neighborhood alone, Swedish was spoken across the street. Everybody's grandparents lived in our houses. Up the street, my friend Danny Thomas, his grandfather spoke Welsh, Radziski Polish, Vitali Italian, and we were the Hungarians. And so everybody was trying to, whether we understood what was being said or not, we were trying to constantly read the voice tones. The tones of voice. Mm-hmm. Voices were what tipped us off, because everyone spoke with their hands, so the same gesture for making a funny joke could be the same gesture that my father would use to knock me off my chair at the dinner table. Mm-hmm. So we were continually having to read the tones of voices to figure out what was going on.
That's actually a good thing. I've done that with my brother as well.
Much like reading poetry. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't understand a lot of what's going on in poetry, but I can read, thanks to my upbringing, I can read the tone of voice of what's being said into what else is being said next, and I can get it.
Well, isn't there some poetry out there, I'm not quite sure what you call it, that is just gutturalization? There are some poets that express themselves by.
Michael McClure was the big one of the beats. Yeah. But sure, there's like animal noises were the first poetry in the cosmos. So sure, I try to make as many animal noises in my poems as possible, especially when my bifocals slip.
Just to add to my parents also came from the coal regions.
Where?
From Shamokin.
Oh, I know Shamokin. I know. Yeah. I lived in the Madison Hotel across from Novak's Bar, and I know the Bloody Fifth very well. Mm-hmm. This book, God's Shiny Glass Eye, came out of Shamokin.
Really?
Wow. Yeah.
Would you like to read a poem?
I'll read you a Shamokin poem.
Read me a Shamokin
poem. It's lovely. Mm-hmm. I was living in Shamokin, and reading the French writer Emile Zola, yeah. And he has a novel called Germinal, which is about the coal region, living in the coal mines in France. So I'm reading him, and I'm reading myself at the same time, as well as reading the people, the landscape, the gouged earth, the gouged people, the acid creek, mm-hmm. and the slag heaps. This is a poem called Zola in Shimokin. The view to the right was blocked by the slag heap. No, Emil. The view to the right is the slag heap. And he goes on to say, rising colossal like a giant's earthwork consumed by an inner fire, which has been burning with dense smoke, and as it burned has left long trails of bloody rust on the surface of dull gray shale and sandstone. That's Zola from Germinal. Here's Czury from Shimokin. I just need a small room with a bed, room enough not to avoid myself, and a town the mere image of how I'm feeling tired, but full of guts for what I don't know anything about. Out of distance to the Sulphur Creek, I leave the bathwater running and fry those scabby apples from the tree alongside the creek with rice. Becoming mine slag, Emil, your eyes will be the first sign of dingy soot grown dim, then darker shale in a gaze of two round bones staring black into their gutted heart marrow. The open vowels of our speech fill with a garbled native soil and an endless longing to lie smoldering in a white bed of coals, shadow to a heap of cindering teeth. It was hard living in these towns and as a kid outside of Wilkes-Barre. In high school, the strongest message sent to all of us was, life is elsewhere. As I explained, I grew up in a neighborhood where everybody spoke these old European languages, and they sent us to high school to study French and Spanish. Well, it wasn't until I left, and thank my father for always picking up hitchhikers, all it took to leave town was the drop of my thumb. And I'd be gone, and I was gone many times, as far as I could get, until I ended up out in Montana with a group of men who were pretty rugged guys, and they wrote poetry. And they made a lot of sense to me. Well, I also discovered poetry in translation. You mentioned Robert Bly before, and Robert Bly was the first poet of my generation to bring us Pablo Neruda from Chile, and Cesar Vallejo from Peru, and all of the great Spanish surrealists who came out of the ground like gnarled potatoes, unlike the French who come out of the sky. So I those were the poets who were talking to me just because of how gnarled the life and oppressed the life was up in the coal regions. So I understood these poets. And they came to me in translation. And that's the part when I discovered poetry as broken English and poetry with all of the white space, all of this marvelous white space on the page. And that just allows my eyes to rest, be still, become a little quieter until the words start to speak a few at a time. That was great. That was fantastic.
Do you prefer the more earthy tones of poetry as opposed to the more efflorescent?
I tried to get efflorescent. I tried to wear Hawaiian shirts, too. It didn't work. I like, there are some of my poems that I'm able to get out into the cosmos and then come back. But I'm not using an effervescent language. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like when the coal trucks come rumbling down the Bloody Fifth. It's like not just the miners contract black lung, but the people who live in those houses come down with black lung too. So as the dust particles go out, they come back with something that's familiar, but not always good for us.
Yeah. Well, excuse me for coughing every now and then. I'm just coming off of a cold.
You want a drink?
No, I haven't.
You want some gum? Here.
No, we're good.
Oh, here's some gum. Mm-hmm. It's a piece of anthracite. Here.
Well, thank you. But,
No, I always carry a piece of anthracite with me.
Look at that.
Huh. What are they? What kind of candy is that? What? There's a hard rock candy that people buy in stores. What's it called? Do you ever that?
Sen something?
I don't know. Maybe it's just like hard rock candy.
Yeah, I don't know. It's a licorice or some kind.
I don't know. Yeah. Okay. Well. I tried to get poetry when I was in high school, and it was hard because all they gave us were those lovely British poets. And first of all, there wasn't anybody who talked like them in where I grew up. So it was really hard to relate not just what they were talking or how come they were talking like that, but it's like they were talking about all this stuff that was lovely.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I didn't get it. I didn't get it, or just being a guy in the coal region, I didn't allow myself to get it, or the region didn't allow me to get it. Let's go there.
Well, you weren't associating with that part of it. Your life had more of a solid grounding where you lived with people that didn't
that worked for a living.
Yeah, right.
It was their hands. There were no poets, and that's something I had to conceal my entire adolescence up into my 20s. I had to conceal the fact that I was writing poetry, you know, and I could have had a good shill. I was a co-captain of the football team. I was an all-star baseball player. Mm-hmm. So it's like I was like everything was normal on the surface. Mm-hmm. And I was getting whacked when I was a kid at home all the time. Well, that was normal, but I was continually being sent to my room over something as simple as language. You're going to talk like that at the dinner table, go to your room. And I was continually sent to my room with this burning inside of me that just had to, I mean, what do you do with all of your wild and crazy, wild and brilliant thoughts that you never tell anybody? Or you're not allowed to tell anybody. That was the case in my house. So, filled with all of that language, mm-hmm. That's where my first writing came from.
So you saved it, more or less.
Well, I did. I mean, yeah. Where's it go? Where do your brilliant ideas go if you don't tell anybody?
Well, they go onto paper, and
you get them
paper,
there.
And then people read it, and that's.
I don't know. Do you read poetry? Yeah.
Well, you listen to music.
Of course he does.
Yeah, man.
Well, shit, he...
Rap, that sort of thing?
You probably know thousands of poems by heart simply because you know you can sing along to the songs you love. Right?
If you call the songs poetry, yeah.
Song lyrics are definitely poetry. Your English teacher won't tell you that.
Yeah.
I hope they do. I mean, it's like... Your English teachers are younger than me right now. They should know this. Okay.
Well, they like... Tupac Shakur, you know what I mean?
I like Tupac. Tupac. I'm into Tupac.
Well, I heard he was a required reading at one college in Florida.
Oh, see, there's hope.
Yep.
There's hope.
Okay. Well, I've seen in your writing a very visual, how would you say, a visionary context. When you read something, it seems like there's a picture that you can envision. It's like when something comes across, you actually see it in you can see it in your mind. It's not like you're describing something. It's like you're being somewhere.
That's what I like.
I like that too.
Because you can't. What are you going to write about if you haven't seen it?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I state that in all of my workshops and classes, and every time I even try to write about writing, you can't write until you see. And that's the mm-hmm. part, you know, spending over 25 years going into schools, going into elementary schools, going into middle schools, which I love the most because I, having flunked the eighth grade, I like the eighth graders. I got a chance to be there twice. But I trust that the teachers in schools are teaching the kids how to write. I have to trust that. But I'm not certain in this culture who's teaching young people to see. And it's that active vision, that active actually making one still enough to welcome vision or to go after it. It's something that the arts and the art or the artists continually, I mean, we live for that moment. We live for light, variations of light and variations of silence in order to give us vision. Mm-hmm. And once we have vision, and vision can come in color, vision can come in sound, vision can come in body movement. We all enter the same space. I enter a blank sheet of paper with my head down as if praying, and I look for vision. Or I enter a room that's blank, empty room, and I need to be able to see where my body is going to fit into that room or the blank canvas. It also
helps to have a very varied set of experiences, too. I mean, from that list that I read here earlier, my goodness, I mean, that's like you're living your life. You're out there doing all kinds of different things, and your poetry is mediating that. And any artist that lives their life mediates their life through their art.
Yeah, but listen, my mother and I have this running argument, even though she's been dead for many years. She and I have this enormous argument and disagreement over the amount of times that I ran away from home as a kid against the amount of times that she threw me out of the house when I was a kid. And we go back and forth on this. And she comes to this, her final conclusion, when she could come to a conclusion, was, well, you know, I had to throw you out. You would have run away anyway. In a mother's infinite wisdom. So, yeah, I'm not sure that I actually went out into the world to have experience. And again, I feel sorry for the kids today who can't hitchhike, who need money to get into a car and fire it up down the highway. But over the years that I spent hitchhiking, that's all I had to do. I left California one time. I had 38 cents in my pocket. And nobody can leave that way again. Mm-hmm. Nobody can do that. You can't. It was out of whatever acts of desperation that you need to leave. I hate to think that you can't leave until you have money. But I'm speaking as a guy also. I mean, that's a privilege I had as a young man. Although women did that too, but still,
not as easily.
There were more guys out on the highway.
Yeah. Took a lot of guts for a woman to do something like that.
Or adventure. But you're right. I mean, yes, a lifetime of experience. I sit down to write a poem, and if I'm sitting at the Schuylkill River, you know, it's going to have the river in it, but it ain't going to be a poem about the river. It's going to be a poem about something that goes back to something that hit me when I was younger.
It's a little broader, a little more broader base. It encompasses everything.
Yeah,
literally, it encompasses everything that you can think about.
Carl Jung would say so. I'm with him.
Yeah, he was a pretty smart guy.
Well, he was our best ally. If we were going to turn to anyone who would really get to the core of what the poets and artists and creative thinkers are after with vision and visionary imagery. He's the one.
Would you like to read another poem?
Yeah. What do you have?
Anything.
What do I have? I have a poem about the river. Heather and I live on River Road. We live on the Schuylkill, across the street from the Schuylkill River. And as many years as we've lived there, we drive it, we walk it, we bicycle it. But it wasn't until we started putting our dupas in big truck tires that float from Felix Dam down to Kelly's Locks did we really have a sense that the river has its own timing. The river has its own flow and pace. And once you put yourself on the river, you realize that how fast your car goes or your bicycle or your walking is irrelevant to anything that's attached to this earth and has the flow of the earth. This is a poem. I could say these are poems that I wrote while tubing the river. They are. But as I said before, it's from a collection called Parallel River Time. Through this world, how is it we float? We don't. How is it we stay afloat without using our arms? We don't. How is it we're up to our necks and don't sink further? We've already. And don't fall all the way through without using our, yes, we do, only our heads, you think? Then how is it with you on the opposite bank, under the opposite bank? A rooster crows inside the river.
Wow.
Well, we had chickens.
Okay. We are to take a break.
Oh, that's a good line to take a break on.
Yeah. We had chickens. Keep that thought. We'll be right back.
You're watching New Arts Alive on bctv.org. Be informed. Be involved. Be a member. For membership information, go to www.bctv.org/support/membership. For more information and an arts calendar, go to www.bctv.org.
Arts programming on BCTV is supported by the Pennsylvania Partners in the Arts, Berks Arts Council, and the Wells Fargo Foundation.
Here we are. Boy, that was fast. Okay, here we are again, and I just want to remind everybody that we are broadcasting from the Berks Community Television cable network stations here in Reading, Pennsylvania.
Are we live?
Yeah, we're live.
Huh.
Mm-hmm. And we have with us, we have Craig Czury, Poet Laureate of Berks County. So
thanks, Ron.
We have, you were talking, we had chickens.
Well, my stepson, Heather's son, Ian Forrester, inherited the incubator chicken egg project from the fourth grade. It's a big science project. Everyone's gone through it. Except at the end, after they all hatch, the teacher says, all right, so who wants these chickens? So the kid comes home off the school bus with his box, cardboard box full of chickens. And for years we had chickens. Oh, it was wonderful. But the most ferocious roosters came out of that batch. And there were times when we did hear the rooster crowing from inside the river. Well, they would get loose, and there are times, depending on when the river's down,
yeah,
they would just go out onto the island.
And they would drown.
Oh, they wouldn't drown. No, they'd live for a long time out there. That was all right.
Ooh.
So you can't write a poem about the river without something else coming into it.
Without something else coming to it. And that was something from your personal life from long ago.
Can I follow up with that?
Absolutely. Please do. Yeah.
To give it more context?
Mm-hmm.
We live on Lizzie's Bridge. I say we do. Heather says we live on Lizzie's Bridge Road, but I've lived on the edge and over the edge many times that I need the bridge right now. So. And of course, the bridge isn't there. The bridge. We'd like to show you, as we've imagined, resplendent width of air crossing water across air, the span weight of, to the right, a beginning. To the left, we have beginning Any notion of God beyond this space, we like to show you the hold and letting go each way against the, which on most days is not the, by way of stepping.
Context.
Yeah. The poem about the bridge that is not a bridge, but includes everything I've survived in life, possibly.
So maybe a poem about transitioning and...
Hey.
You know.
Hey. That'd be all right.
Yeah. Moving from one spot to another, crossing over.
And just being there.
Yeah.
In between, where there's nothing. Well.
I've been there.
Is this a phone-in show? We take some phone-in calls on being there also?
Yeah, this is live, so if anybody does want to call in here, the telephone number here is 610-378-0426. Please call in. Any questions for Craig?
Oh. Well, my friend Barry always watches the show.
Mm-hmm. So, would you like to read another one?
How about,
Yeah.
I'll read a poem. I've got this new project that it's one thing, coming back from, travels and readings and festivals and, having my classes at Albright College and my classes at the Goggle Works and now the Tea Factory. Let's talk about the Tea Factory.
That's right. Too. That's right.
But because that's a new exciting art space for technology and arts and workshops and yoga and music studio, but I've also got this enormous project up in the Marcellus natural gas drilling region up in Susquehanna County, where I have been. I turned 60 this year, and Heather took a. Heather's funny sometimes. She'll look at me and she'll say, "God, Craig, I think you're depressed." I say, what do you mean I'm depressed? I'm from the coal region and I write poetry. Come on. Come on. I say, have we met? Have you met me? Well, she said one of the wisest things she said. She said, well, Craig, I think you ought to go find something you used to have a passion for and go do it all over again. And I thought, well, this is a good one. So... In this Marcellus Shale fracking project of mine, I'm living in an old schoolhouse up in Springville next to Dimmock. And every morning when it's a day like today, I get on Route 29 in front of Joe's garage, and I start hitchhiking north toward Montrose. And my intention is I'm conducting a series of interviews. Well, how am I going to meet the people? How am I going to meet the entire variety of people there are living up there? Unless I, and unbeknownst to who stops for me, they're in the middle of an interview. Well, the gas workers pick me up, the locals pick me up, farmers pick me up, the redneck locals pick me up who want to kill the gas workers with baseball bats, women pick me up. And I get the story of what it is to live in the middle of this huge industrial boom that's causing enormous problems. And I get to hear every story that there could possibly be from any direction. Mm-hmm. It's fantastic. So I've been writing this. This is a new book I'll call Thumb Notes Almanac. And the notes that I've been taking and writing down these interviews are amazing. I'm going back for another series of hitchhikes up there to develop this poem. But here's a poem. And this gives you a sense of the landscape. Once again, landscape. Once again, an attachment to the earth and distinct issues of the earth. I'm going up past Dimmock, which is famous through the Gasland movie. Evening sky, diesel blue purple tinge. last of the sun burnt white through a stand of maples past the drill rig, then rolled down over the hill. Hayfield mowed into rolls slit up its gut through the shoulder, pipelined. Tomorrow this gaping trench will be backhoed shut, leaving a long blood rose stem after bypass. If you were to tell me the patient has 100% chance of recovery, I'd plant carrots and onions, a long corridor of sweet corn and cabbages in this scar. End to end, the cemeteries are a feeding tube of bones blanched in the vapors of black poppies. What I want is what others around the world wanted and gave their lives for, to drink from your mouth and say, this is good.
You have to absorb these. These are really beautiful poems. Very strong.
Thanks.
Very deep.
Well, it's deep. It's a deep earth. It's a deep issue, mm-hmm. and mm-hmm. there is no one way to look at it.
Right. Okay. You just came back from, well, we'll talk about the tea factory.
Yeah,
too.
Sure.
But you just came back from Sarajevo a little while ago, too. What were we doing out there?
I had a reading tour through Bosnia and Herzegovina. Heather came with me. She was part of it. International Poetry Day Festival. It took place in Sarajevo, but as we arrived early, I was whisked off into the countryside. And you know, their war wasn't too long ago. It was regarded as a genocide. And the acres and acres of public parks and in the city of Sarajevo are now cemeteries, Muslim cemeteries. But even going up into Travnik and then up into the mountains, where there was a lot of fighting, the small villages, the Muslim villages with their mosques and spires, and Christian villages with their church and Franciscan monastery, and there's a school where I went to read poems to seventh graders, and it was a wonderful school, the Gucia Gora Primary School, and the kids were all spoke English, and wide-eyed and just enamored of the poets. I went with an Israeli poet and a Romanian poet, two poets whom I've known for years through other festivals, and it was really wonderful. But Heather and I gave readings in Sarajevo at the synagogue, the Jewish synagogue in Sarajevo, and in a place in the open market that was a house of one of their regarded poets. And we were treated very well. We made a lot of camaraderie, good camaraderie, with our international friends, and mm-hmm. Hope to see them on this side at our house and in our schools.
Poetry was a really big art form, major art form, you know, in early Byzantine times, yeah. And Arabic times, where they actually had court poets and such. You find that has lessened any right now, or is
no, that? Not at all, because you see Yohani Cepeda's article faces in the news in today's paper, right after the front page. Yohani's article is in there. She has Mikasa Sukasa restaurant down on Penn Street next to the peanut bar, and it is probably one of the liveliest poetry scenes, and it reminds me of the old Arab poets. I'm thinking especially of the Tuareg tribe in North Africa, who have an evening ritual of sitting in circles, like a drum circle, except these are poet circles, mm-hmm. and someone will start out with a story of the day in a rhythmic form, in a rhythmic cadence, song cadence, and will take it as far as until the person next to him either interrupts, not interrupts, but just weaves his voice in, and takes it the story further in that direction. Well, I'm listening to these hip hop cats down at the Mikasa Sukasa, and the Reading Hip Hop Summit is one of the liveliest scenes that I've been a part of in a long time. These are young guys and gals, and they've got hip-hop, music, poetry. The B-boys are out there rolling around on the floor. I'll whip out my harmonica and jump in, but it's got a lively, positive, honest to God, they came up with something I never even considered. A phrase. I love Reading. It's like, what are they talking about? I read the newspapers. But it's like total turnaround. And what their poems have to talk about, it's a community. It's a community of poetic voices. And when they get together with their cipher, it's the same thing as the Tuaregs, it's the same thing as the Arab poets in their community singing the news of the day. They are singing each other after the other, the news of the day. So
I think we have a really active hip hop community in this area where they are very creative and very good. We have to get Ed Terrell in on this sometime.
Ed's in. No, Ed's yeah. in on it. Ed's in. Mm-hmm. I mean, he and I are the old dogs and a couple others, and we're in on that. Mm-hmm. And it's I supported this Saturday, I think, the first Saturday of each month. Berks Bards has an event at the Goggle Works. So poetry has been alive in this community mm-hmm. for a long time. And, you know, I'll start it with Wallace Stevens and Byron Vizakis.
Right.
You know, and take it on up to what's... But here's information, poetry. The Cucina Cafe Goggle Works, Thursday, April 5th. Joe Ross, who's a former publisher of the Washington Review, who's published my work over years. He's coming here with Courtney Bedsoe. They are the featured readers at the Goggle Works, 6 o'clock, Thursday. And open to the public with an open mic afterwards. Bring your poems.
And that is free of charge. Come on in.
And then Saturday night's the Hip Hop Summit at Mikasa Tsukasa, 7 till midnight.
So also about poetry for the tea.
Tea Factory is this new cooperative art space on Willow Street. It's on the building of Canal Street Pub. It's directly behind it. Bill's Khakis and several art studios are there.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And they, if you want to know more about that,
you can just go Google Berks Bards.
Google Tea Factory, T.E.A. So, technology, education, entertainment, arts. It's a cooperative, and they welcome, and they have a recording studio, they have yoga studio, they have, my gulag is my poetry and memoir classes every Thursday night. If you're interested, Google the information and come.
Exactly. Unless you have a website, just give them the website.
Like I think they have a website. I have a website, but it's not on it.
What's your website?
CraigCzury.com. Just first last name together, .com.
Easy enough.
Yeah.
So, let's see. We have about maybe 10 to 12 minutes left. Would you like to read another poem?
Yeah. What kind do you want to hear?
I'll leave that up to you.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Here's a poem. Every now and then I'm asked to write about what it is to be a poet, or what writing's supposed to, what it's all about. So here's a poem. It's called To My Readers. I listen to you breathe while you're reading. The earth is round. It's spinning. Okay. But I go to amusement parks. I know round and spinning. I have a woman who is round and spinning. She tells me I'm her only one. She tells me I'm her very first. Her son? An immaculate conception. Come on. I write poetry. I know Immaculate Conception. I have this poem, An Immaculate Conception. It tells me I'm its God. It tells me you're a figment of my imagination. All right. But I have a mirror above my sink. I know figment of imagination.
So, do you have a definition for poetry? Do you have some sort of way that you can... I mean, that's kind of a crazy question, really. But
You have a definition for breathing, a definition... I'll try it. Because, you know, it's like poets have said witty things about what they think poems are. And...
Well, I haven't really ever really seen... Maybe I haven't read enough poetry, but I haven't really seen a poet that doesn't talk about poetry.
Well, I can talk about poetry, but I won't try to name what it is.
Mm-hmm.
I'll talk about that moment when you say something that's so incredible that a woman will kiss you because of it. And then you have to wonder, what was it I really said? And you don't know what you said, but it was a moment that was rewarded with something precious. That's what poetry is.
Okay, put your books down, everybody, you know. Well, no, we just, I don't know, poetry. I don't know, poetry is just putting it down. I don't know what I can say about poetry, because I write poetry too, but it's not...
Rachel Chambers and I had a collaboration show at Glenn and Peg's gallery. What was that? Studio...
Gallery 908.
908.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Peg and Glenn Spears.
Great people.
And it was wonderful. It's a wonderful gallery, and I'm sure it's just like waiting for the next show. But Rachel, who is a fiber artist, wanted to use my poems. We'd been talking about the concept of a palimpsest. Now, when I learned the word palimpsest, and I never thought in my life I would ever hear it coming out of my mouth. Mm-hmm. It's a language that is written over by another language, but still bleeds through. If you go into New York, you see those walls of billboards, playbills. And they're scraped off or weathered off, and others are put on top. But what was under, layers and layers, but what comes and what bleeds through. Well, she created these fiber constructions that had openings. She had worked my poems underneath them, so depending on which angle you looked at them from, you could see scraps of the language of my poems coming through. Talk about animal noises as poetry. What you weren't getting whole phrases, you weren't even getting whole words, you were getting fragments of language coming through her fabrics. It was wonderful.
I thought they were beautiful. Yeah. I saw that. I wrote about that show.
I had never seen my poems in that context or in that light before, and I thought, yes, because that's all it's all we get from even conversations with people. We walk away from a conversation and it's like, well, what did he say? Well, a lot of us can only remember parts of what they said, and is possibly wrong too. Or that's what I come away from poetry with. I come back with fragments of understanding, or even what I saw, and I say thank you in this world. Mm-hmm. Thank you for those fragments.
Mm-hmm. My family. We were talking about families earlier. Everybody knew each other by a joke.
Huh.
They had a specific kind of joke, where my uncle had a joke that he told every time he'd come by, and everybody would laugh like the first time they'd ever heard it.
Yeah.
It would be the same thing with every member of the family. We would have Uncle Joe's joke and Aunt Olga's joke, and
But that happens when poets get together, because we each of us have our what do they call that? Our signature poems.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, oh, he's the poet from the coal region. oh, she's the poet from the trees and leaves and you know, fish coming out of the attic.
Fish coming out of the attic. I heard that one.
That's a great poem. That's a great
cool.
One.
Yeah. Yeah, so. I'd love to hear. Mm-hmm. Love to hear these. So, and also at this month, this is National Poetry Month.
National Poet. There are poetry readings, which makes it even a greater honor to be on your show today, because there's poetry happening all over the world right now, all over the country now, in the most unlikely places. You know, they're in homeless shelters, in mental hospitals, in police athletic leagues, in YMCAs, and there's poetry, and kids coming together with poetry, and old people coming together with poetry. So yeah, it's National Poetry Month. Mm-hmm. You'll hear more. Listen to the radio. You'll hear poems being broadcast.
Well, it's something that you can do, too. I've always thought of this, you know, ever since I was a kid. It's like you were saying, like, where do you go with this stuff if you're not allowed to say it? I mean, you have a whole arsenal at your convenience where you were able to express yourself, say what you want, you know, under any conditions for anything at all, and there you have it, and you've got the freedom to do that. So poetry allows that, and you don't need anything. Really, a piece of paper and
a burnt match and a napkin.
Yeah.
Yep. Or like those Russian poets who memorize thousands of lines of a poem to entertain themselves because they're in prison. But it's a great Russian tradition. Russian tradition of being a poet is, number one, you're going to get thrown in jail or sent off to a gulag. But the second part of that tradition is, when you come out, you're going to know an epic poem by memory.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. One of my favorite jokes is by Steve Reich, I think. And he had these existential jokes where he would say that he creates beautiful abstract paintings in his mind.
There you go.
So I think one of these days that could possibly save my life.
Well, they're going to have ways of getting it out by then.
By then, they'll be able to
project it.
Yeah.
Electrodes. Yeah. Yeah. We got it. We're not that old.
Okay. Well, we have about 2.5 minutes left.
Uh huh.
Would you like to end it on a poem?
I would. I would, because inheritance has been a big issue. Not the act of waiting around for some old guy to croak in order to get his dough, but what you've inherited through how you've grown up, who you grew up with, where you grew up, and inheritance for me means what I've collected. Opening a tremendous silence between us, I measure inheritance in a tone of voice. Underneath that certain look, what was it we were promised? A particular gesture traced back to, what was it we had to let go? Someone, somewhere, recognizable a long time ago. Where in the Bible does it say unconditional? I read the newspapers. Was there something eating you from what you didn't get last time? Here, I give you everything I've found since a boy. A few hard-placed words, and this moment, listening.
Wow. See, like, you don't really want to have them explained. You know, I mean, sometimes you could say, well, you know, what's that about? You know, or what's it? What's the purpose of it?
Someone who read Ezra Pound's poems every week in this one journal came said to him one time, "Ez, you know, I always read your poems. I love your poems, but you know that last one I read, I don't get it. Could you explain that to me?" And Ezra Pound said, "Sure, come over to my house tonight, and I'll read it to you."
There you go.
Life is simple.
Life is simple. Very simple. Well, I do want to thank you.
Thank you, Ron.
For being my
Thanks.
Guest here tonight.
Thank you, James Carroll.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, James. Absolutely. And, well, we just have just a little bit left here. We have maybe about a minute yet. Shall I do another one?
I think maybe I'll read the events, poetry events. I have to mention Rufino's Secret. Rick Kearns Morales, who is one of the stars of Reading via Harrisburg, will be reading at Mikasa Su Casa on April 14th, Saturday night, 8 p.m., starting at 8 p.m. His new book is just out, and that's exciting. He was part of the poetry scene when I had it at the Puerto Rican Latin Association on 8th and what a Cherry, 8th and, well, what 8th Street. But anyway, Rick's reading, Shillington Mifflin Community Library. There's an open mic on April 19th. And we're out of time.
And we're out of time. How about that? Okay, well, thank you very much for tuning in. This is Ron Czury with Rick Czury on New Arts Alive. And thank you very much. Have a good night.
Thank you.
New Arts Alive is produced through Berks Community Television and can be seen live on the second Tuesday of each month at 5 p.m. Consult your local community cable service for live and repeat programming. For more information about the New Arts program and its consultation residencies of artists from the literary, visual, and performing arts, call 683-6440 or write New Arts Program, P.O. Box 82, Kutztown, PA 19530. Or visit the office and exhibition space at 173 West Main Street, Kutztown, PA.
Hours are Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, 1 to 5, Saturday, 10 to 2, or by appointment.